Let me say it's a very big honor and a pleasure to be here with you. It's a very big honor to have been invited in your country, not only to speak at the Senate yesterday about the similarities of the scheme of debt in Greece and in Brazil, but also to speak to you today. I'm very glad to be among students. I'm very glad to be in a university. I'm very glad to be among people who not only seek the truth, but demand the truth, demand to know what's happening to their country, to their co-citizens, what's happening in the world, and how populations are being victimized through a very well-crafted system which has been implemented worldwide during the last years. Before I start my presentation, I would like to wholeheartedly thank Maria Lucia Fatorelli for everything that she has done for my country. Maria Lucia accepted to be part of the Truth Committee on Public Debt, a committee which was founded on April 2015, when I was President of Parliament, to investigate the debt in Greece, to show the truth about the debt in Greece. Maria Lucia accepted to come to Greece for several weeks with no remuneration, with absolutely no gain, but with the decisiveness, the will to contribute to liberating a people, liberating the Greek people for what has become a prison for the people. The debt. The debt is not about economic relations. Don't be fooled. The debt is about political imposition. The debt is about enslaving countries and whole populations. The debt is about the misappropriation of public property and public money. The debt is about violating people's rights. The debt is about stealing the lives of the young generations, of the living generations, but also of the unborn, of the future generations. And this is why I'm here. This is why I became involved in politics in the first place back in 2012. Because I believe that there is not just a right, but there's also a fundamental democratic duty lying with each and every one of us to struggle, to fight, to participate in a battle against what constitutes a new type of totalitarianism, a new type of authoritarian imposition upon the living populations. Let me tell you about my country. Let me tell you about Greece. And before I tell you about Greece, let me ask you, who among you have ever been in Greece? Okay. And who among you would like to come to Greece? Very good, you're all invited. You're all invited to come and fight with us. Back in 2010, the Greeks had no idea of what would happen to them. They had just elected a government who had a slogan, "There is money." That was the slogan of the PASOK government back in 2009, 2010. And suddenly, in 2010, they were told that their economy is sinking like the Titanic. They were told that the country was over-indebted and on the verge of bankruptcy. They were also told it was their fault that they had been overspending, that they had been living beyond their means. They were depicted in the international media as lazy and corrupt. And then they were asked to make sacrifices. Sacrifices to save their country which they love and cherish. And suddenly, in May 2010, the country entered an agreement. This agreement was characterized a bailout agreement, a salvation agreement, an agreement which would help the country repay its debt. Who concluded this agreement? Well, on the one hand, members of the Greek government, actually without ever consulting the parliament. On the other hand, it was international institutions, the International Monetary Fund, the IMF, which you very well know, and organs of the European Union, the European Commission, the European Central Bank. These three, the European Central Bank, the European Commission, and the International Monetary Fund, through their agents, that is, through employees who have absolutely no democratic legitimation, who have never been elected by the people, who have never, ever run before the people, formed what was called the Troika. The Troika was a team of bureaucrats, a team of so-called technocrats, who would supervise Greece. And what do we mean by supervise Greece? Well, we actually mean reign Greece. We actually mean govern Greece. Because those agreements which were concluded in 2010, the loan agreements, basically consisted on a twofold understanding. On the one hand, the Troika would supposedly give loans to Greece in order for Greece to repay its debt. On the other hand, the Greek government had to abide by the rules dictated by the Troika. And what were those rules? These rules were drafted in what was called a memorandum of understanding, an agreement on how to enforce the loan agreements. And this memorandum of understanding basically demanded that Greece surrenders itself, that Greece surrenders its sovereignty, its parliamentary sovereignty, its democratic procedure, it surrenders human rights, and it gives away public property and public wealth. I'm not exaggerating. What was asked of Greece was to vote laws, for the parliament to vote laws that the members of parliament had never even read. We're talking about laws of hundreds of pages, which were introduced in Parliament in less than 24 hours and voted upon under the explicit threat that if they were not voted, no disbursement of loans would be effectuated and the country would go bankrupt. And so started the thriller, the debt thriller, which has been experienced in Greece ever since 2010. Extreme measures, extraordinary procedures, legislation circumventing the parliament, and a vicious and violent attack on the population, which has been, through such laws, deprived of its fundamental rights. We're talking about inhumane cuts on wages and salaries. We're talking about unprecedented cuts in public spending in all fields of the social state, of the welfare state. We're talking about cuts in education, cuts in health, cuts in social security. And if you think that, well, maybe Greece was spending a lot and there should be some cuts, let me just tell you that the result of these cuts, which were also translated into cuts in jobs, was that in Greek public hospitals, you would have, and you still do actually, one nurse for 40 patients. It would also mean that several schools in the public sector operate without books, without heating, and very often without teachers. It means that children faint at school out of starvation, and we have in Greece one out of two children living below the poverty line. It means we have one out of two pensioners living below the poverty line. It means we have the youth in a total state of despair, where 72% of young women are unemployed and 60% of young men are unemployed. In total, 30% of the population is unemployed. And we have had hundreds of thousands of youngsters and scientists emigrating because they can't find a job in the country. We have had hundreds of thousands of medium and small enterprises closing because they cannot afford to pay the tax tsunami that has been imposed upon the country. Now, all this was the result of measures taken to supposedly repay the debt. In addition to that, there was a fearful, a violent privatization policy. Greece was asked to give away its public infrastructure, its most strategic public enterprises, the enterprise on electricity, the enterprises involving water, and basically a series of assets constituting Greece's patrimoine. Now the people, because they are connected to their reality, they knew very well, ever since the beginning, that they couldn't have spent so much to deserve this. They couldn't have spent so much to have to die in order to repay. And I'm not exaggerating. We have had deaths because of the memoranda policies. We have had an explosion of suicides because of the memoranda policies. We have had people dying trying to heat themselves with self-made heating machines. And I'm not talking about people in isolated parts of the country. I'm talking also about people in the main cities. We have had young men dying in a city in Greece. They were just students, and a young girl also dying in the second biggest city of Greece, Thessaloniki, out of self-made heating machines. The people knew they hadn't spent so much. The people knew the state never spent so much for them. So ever since 2011, they started questioning the debt. They started demanding that the debt be investigated. They started demanding the truth about how this debt that they are asked to pay has been created. Who created it? Who spent what? And for what purpose? Was it legally spent? Was it legally concluded? This was one of the most powerful social movements born in Greece during the Memoranda period. And this movement led to a political commitment by parties which were then in opposition. Syriza, the major opposition party at that point, the party to which I belonged and to which I don't belong anymore because it lost its soul and its credibility. Syriza. It's painful, but it's also true. Syriza undertook this social demand for a debt audit as a political commitment. And we said back then that we are going to audit the debt. And we're not going to make Greeks pay for what they do not owe. We're not going to let the people pay for what corrupt governments have created as public debt. In 2015, Syriza was elected to power, and I became the president of the Hellenic Parliament. And it was my commitment, and it was my duty to do what I had said I would do. I initiated the procedures and created a debt truth committee. The Truth Committee on Public Debt, created less than 2 months after the parliament was convened on the 4th of April of 2015, as an international committee of the parliament with international members, with experts, academics, but also members of the society, members of the social movements, citizens. An open committee which operated publicly with its works being transmitted through the parliament channel and through the parliament website, and with all its findings being publicized. This committee worked very hard. It worked very hard to really look into what this debt meant, what this debt was constituted of. And the committee produced a very important report, the preliminary report of June 2015, which I brought here with me. It's this report. Actually, this is very rare, because the new president of parliament has locked the rest of the reports in a room, and he has taken down the parliament website, these reports. So I brought some reports with me to leave for you at the university, and I'm sure you'll make good use of them. These are I'm very persistent, as some of my friends know. These reports showed what the Greek people knew in their hearts and knew from experience, that the Greek debt does not correspond to public expenses made for the people. It showed that public expenses in Greece had been well below the European average all the previous years, meaning previous to 2010. The report showed that Greece's debt had nothing to do with public expenses for the public interest, and indeed, the only public sector in which expenses were higher than the European average is which one? Could you take a guess? Very good. Defense, military expenses. And guess what? There are some dozens of criminal case files for corruption cases involving defense deals, involving armaments deals, and involving Greek government officials, but also representatives of foreign companies, mainly German, French, and American. These are criminal case files which prove that a large part of the Greek debt is connected to corruption and is therefore odious. But this was not all. What was shown through our committee's work was that back in 2010, back when the first memorandum was concluded, because we have had a second one in 2012, and unfortunately, a third one in August 2015. Back when the first memorandum was concluded, back when Greece was subjected to this atrocious regime, which I call, and which we call, the memoranda regime, there was a specific deliberation in the IMF, in the International Monetary Fund. They examined Greece's debt. They examined all the parameters. And they concluded that this debt is unsustainable. What does unsustainable mean? An unsustainable debt is a debt which cannot be repaid without undermining the well-being of the population. That means that if you decide to demand a repayment of the debt, you're endangering the population. You're putting the population into harm's way. There are reports and confidential documents which we opened and which we publicized, reports of the IMF back in 2010 saying clearly this is an unsustainable debt, and also saying clearly that trying to make it repaid would mean long-term recession and a rupture of the social tissue. These reports were never revealed. They were concealed. The fact that the debt was unsustainable and couldn't be burdened with more loans and with more debt was concealed. Why? Why? Well, not for the people's sake. It was concealed because at the time, to strike down the debt would mean to cause damages to those who were holding interests on Greece's debt, to those who were holding Greek bonds, and who would be holding Greek bonds. Well, mainly German and French banks. German and French banks who didn't want to lose some dozens of billions of euros through a striking down of the Greek debt. And so the IMF officials conspired to conceal the non-sustainability of the Greek debt. They conspired to conceal the risk for German and French banks. They even changed the statute of the IMF overnight in order to lend Greece money they could legally not lend Greece, and to save the German and the French banks. Within 2 years, the German and the French banks got rid of a large part of the Greek bonds they were holding. The Greek banks, on the contrary, took more Greek bonds. And the head of the Bank of Greece imposed taking Greek bonds among social security funds and also pensioners. So when part of the debt was stricken down in 2012, the German and the French banks didn't lose their money. The Greek and the Cypriot banks were destroyed, and so were some 15,000 petty bond holders, that is, ordinary people who had invested their life saving in Greek bonds, and so were also legal entities of the public sector. These were destroyed. German and French banks were saved. And more loans came, more loans to Greece to repay its debt, more loans to Greece to dictate how to give up democracy and human rights in the country. The committee investigated on the loans as well, and we found out what is really a revolting element, and that is that of those loans given to Greece, supposedly given to Greece, less than 10%, actually only 8%, has been going to the Greek budget ever since 2010. That means that 92% of the loans goes back to the creditors. And actually, it has never even been proven that that 92% ever even passes from the Greek banks. We actually asked to see evidence whether those loans are passing through Greek bank accounts, and the head of the Bank of Greece actually refused to the Parliament's committee to give this evidence, invoking, guess what? Banking secret. A secret, the bank secrecy for public bank accounts, the accounts of the state, towards a parliamentary committee. Well, the Truth Committee on Public Debt also showed very, very clearly that Greece's debt has all elements which make it unpayable and non-payable. It is illegal, it is illegitimate, it is odious, and it is unsustainable. This means that this is a debt which cannot be paid and should not be paid. This means that this is a debt which has been created through grave violations of democratic procedures. This means that this is a debt which has been created through grave and blatant violations of international law, international human rights law, constitutional law, and internal law. This means that this is a debt which must be abolished. This means that this is a debt for which the government had not only a fundamental right, but also a fundamental duty to demand that it is abolished. This is also a debt for which the population has the right to demand not to pay it, and it has the right to refuse to pay it. But unfortunately, this is not what happened in Greece. This is not what happened in Greece. Although the Truth Committee preliminary report of June 2015 shook the IMF, it shook the IMF to the effect that Christine Lagarde, the director of the IMF, was trying to intimidate a major witness before the committee, asking him not to testify. I'm talking about Greece's former representative to the IMF, to whom she sent a letter asking him not to appear before the committee, and also reminding him that he has an immunity which only the IMF can lift. After our report was published, the IMF had to try to at least defend itself. And so it issued a report showing and admitting for the first time that Greece's debt is unsustainable. This was a report dating back on 26th of June 2015. Right at that time, on the 26th of June 2015, the European organs were asking the Greek government to accept to take more measures against the population, cut more wages, impose more taxes, and privatize more. It was asking the Greek government to abolish labor law, to give away the protection of people's homes, to surrender the civil procedure to banks, and to surrender the confiscations procedure to banks. This was an ultimatum which was tabled on the 26th and 27th of June. And vis-a-vis this ultimatum, a referendum was proposed by the government and decided by the parliament. This was the referendum of the 5th of July 2015. This was a referendum for which the Greek people, for the first time, were asked whether they accept to subject themselves to the memoranda measures. The people were asked whether they accept the ultimatum. The people were asked whether they would accept to submit themselves to more austerity and more inhumane measures to repay a debt that was not their own. This was a referendum effectuated under circumstances of extreme economic and mediatic terrorism, of real propaganda against the people's sovereignty. Officials of the European Union were repeatedly saying that should people vote no, this would mean a humanitarian catastrophe, a humanitarian disaster, that people would die if they said no, that people would die if they refused to submit themselves, that people would die if they claimed their freedom, that people would die if they refused to subject themselves to debt. The banks were closed. Liquidity was used as a weapon against the people and against their free will. And yet, the people said a glorious no. A glorious no. A glorious no of 62% of the votes. And this no is our legacy. This no is our inheritance. This no is our duty to resist. Unfortunately, the Tsipras government did not honor the people's no. Unfortunately, the Tsipras government betrayed the people and the country. Tsipras did not use the committee report ever at all, and he didn't even try to respect the popular mandate. And so a third memorandum came in August 2015. And more measures came. And more dictates came. And there were those of us who resisted, and there were those who succumbed. And of course, it's always very annoying when you have decided to betray, to have those who insist on resisting. So the parliament was abruptly dismantled, because the parliament was an annoying parliament. It had a dead truth committee which was ready to issue its second report on the memorandum. It had an investigations committee investigating on the circumstances leading to Greece's subjection to the memorandum. It had a transparency committee investigating on major corruption scandals. It was an annoying parliament. It had a president who voted no again and again to the memorandum and to the memorandum measures. So the parliament was dismantled. And elections were effectuated, and the debt was never even mentioned in the September 2015 elections. It was supposedly going to be treated within a few months. And here we are, end of 2016. What has been happening to Greece ever since September 2015, ever since those unconstitutional elections, snap elections, which were organized in violation of the Constitution and which were effectuated with more than 50% of the people abstaining or casting an invalid or blank vote. What has happened ever since? Tsipras won the election with a 36%, meaning 18%, because as I told you, more than 50% abstained. And ever since, what has been happening is the most atrocious program has been implemented to supposedly repay an ever-inflated debt. The Greek banks were sold off for nothing. The country's total property, I'm talking about everything, is being transferred to a Société Anonyme, a new kind of formation having its seat in Luxembourg and which will liquidate, this is the terminology used, it will liquidate Greece's public property. I'm not talking about just assets, I'm talking about historical and cultural buildings and areas. I'm talking about the enterprises of water and electricity, the country's ports, airports, everything that constitutes a strategic tool. Everything that was not privatized before is now being pushed for privatization. And what about the debt? What do you think has happened with the debt? Well, you think well, nothing has happened with the debt, because the debt is the supreme tool for the enslavement of the population. To admit that you will subject the population to this kind of debt repayment equals giving away your sovereignty, giving away your independence, giving away the people's rights. Right now, what is being voted in the Parliament of Greece has never been not only drafted, but not even discussed in Parliament. Last May, there was a law of 7,500 pages inserted and voted upon in 24 hours. You understand that nobody read it. You understand that those who voted for it had no idea what was in it. And what is worse, this law included a provision which literally abolishes the parliament. This law clearly says that should Greece derail from the budgetary preconditions, then automatic measures will be taken. We don't need the parliament anymore. It was very annoying anyway in the previous periods. So no parliament, automatic measures, automatic legislation. The debt system is actually an attack on democracy. The debt system is an attack on us, on the people. To resist the debt system is an action of democratic conscience. To demand the truth about the debt is an act of democratic resistance. To disseminate the truth about the debt is an act of solidarity, but also of self-respect. If we in Greece had true knowledge of the destruction provoked in your country and in Latin America back in the 80s, if we had concrete knowledge and detailed information, a lot of the destruction which happened to my country ever since 2010 would never have happened. I feel, and this is what I also said yesterday at the Senate, I feel that we're now in a reverse situation. We're in a situation where it's very, very crucial that you in Brazil know what happened in Greece during the last years. Because Greece was and is still used as an experiment field. Greeks are used as guinea pigs by those who wish to reign upon people and upon populations, and those who defy what democracy and dignity and liberty mean. I believe it's of the essence that you learn the lesson of Greece. I want to tell you that people in Greece have not surrendered at all. Don't ever believe that they surrendered. They're ready to fight again, and they will fight again, and I will fight with them. And it's also very important that we fight together. And it's very important that you fight as well. Your own fight, our own fight. Thank you very, very much. And let's all remember that this battle is our own historical battle. People do write history when they decide to fight. So our historical challenge is to write our own history and not to let bankers, technocrats, bureaucrats write it for us. Thank you.